When you go into the library, there are several different categories of books. There are two main categories. There's fiction and there's nonfiction. Fiction meaning that the stories are made up. They're fake. Somebody made them up in their imagination. Nonfiction would be true stories. Over the years, there have been a number of people who said the Bible is a made-up book. It's a fictitious book. It's fiction. There's no truth in it. But I believe those people to be wrong. I believe, like Pat does, that this is the truth. I believe the Bible is the truth. I believe that the Bible is God's word. I believe that it has been given to us so that we might know how to live and what God has done for us and what God is going to do for us in the future. So this morning, in the few remaining minutes we have, I want to give you 10 quick reasons that I believe the Bible to be true. Now, please understand that these are my 10 reasons. Somebody else, if you ask somebody else, they might give you 10 different reasons. And that's one of the great things I love about Scripture, is because when you read Scripture, it speaks to us individually. There are some universal truths. But what makes me believe the Bible is true may be different from what you believe makes the Bible true. And that's okay, because the Bible speaks to us, and that's what it's supposed to do. So number one is this. The first reason that I think the Bible is true is the Bible has stood the test of time. Many scholars are smart people, believe that the very first book of the Bible, which is what, kids, the first book of the Bible? Genesis. Genesis was written about 1500 BC, which means about 1500 years before Jesus came to earth. That means the earliest part of the Bible has been around for over 3,500 years. 3,500 years. That's a long time. That's long enough time that if the Bible was actually fictitious, if the Bible was actually made up, someone would be able to disprove it. Someone would come along and say, you know, I found proof. I've been reading through the Bible, and this is false. And there have been people throughout the years who have said, you know, I'm not sure that's true or not, but, you know, every one of those people has been proven wrong. This is the truth. And through science, our archaeology, our history, this word has always been proven to be true, even if someone says, no, that's false. No, it's not. So that's the first reason. The second reason is this. Jesus has stood the test of time. Many people will say that Jesus is alive. They say, okay, I'll give you that. Jesus was actually alive. They may even say that Jesus is a great teacher. They might even say that Jesus performed a few miracles. But that's it. He's not the Son of God. He's not the Messiah. He's not the Savior. He's not this person. What people don't understand is that during the same time that Jesus was alive, and since Jesus has been alive, there have been all kinds of people who have come along and said they were God. They had followers. They had people who followed them. But every one of those people who have said that they were God have since passed away. And every one of those who followed them have passed away. Jesus is the only one who has come back to life, who is risen, who is living in heaven today, and has millions of followers. The only one. So Jesus has stood the test of time. The third reason is this, the evidence of honesty. The Bible is painfully honest. It shows the good and the bad. It speaks about people like Jacob and Moses and David as being great leaders and servants of God. But then it also mentions that they had their own faults and how God used them in spite of those faults. It speaks about how the people were so wicked that God sent a flood that killed everybody on earth except Noah and his family. It tells us very straight out that we're going to have trouble in this world. It teaches that the road to heaven is very narrow, but the road to hell is very wide. It tells us that Jesus loves us so much that he wants everyone to accept him and live with him in heaven for all eternity. The Bible is not written for those who want an easy answer, but it is written with honesty about life. The fourth item is this. It's preservation. Remember when we said that the Bible is about 3,500 years old? Well, back in 1946, which is 74 years ago, and almost 3,446 years from when the first words of Genesis were written, there was a group of shepherds who walked into a cave in Israel and found one of the most important treasures of all.
they found what is called the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were copies of some of the original writings within scriptures. And one of the documents that they found was a copy of the book of Isaiah, which is actually in your Bible today. And what they found is that the words written on that text are almost identical to the words in our Bible today. And all of this means that over the years, the truth of Scripture has remained and has not changed. So that what we read today in your Bible is the same to what was written all those years ago. It's not changed. A word has not changed. It's been preserved in that kind of pristine state from the very beginning. Number five is this, the evidence of unity. Listen to this, 40 different writers, 40 different authors, writing over a period of 1,600 years, wrote the 66 books of the Bible. 400 years of silence separated the 39 books of the Old Testament and the 27 books of the New Testament. Yet from Genesis, the first book, to Revelation, the last book, they tell one unfolding story. Together, they give the consistent answers to the most important questions we can ask. Why are we here? How can we overcome our fears? How can we get along? How can we rise above the circumstances and keep hope alive? How can we continue to serve God and be sure of our salvation? The Bible's consistent answers to these questions show that the Scriptures are not many books, but one book. Number six is this, the evidence of prophecy. From the days of Moses, the Bible predicted events no one wanted to believe. Before Israel entered into the Promised Land, it was prophesied that Israel would become unfaithful and would lose the land that God was giving to them, and that they would all end up scattered throughout the world, and God would then regather them all up again and bring them back together and establish them into a great nation. God told Abraham in the book of Genesis that the Hebrew children would become so great and many of them, but they would be enslaved in a nation for 400 years, and then he would come and free them. And that's exactly what happened when the children were enslaved in Egypt. The Old Testament is filled with hundreds of prophecies about from the birth of Jesus, and Jesus fulfills every one of them. And not only does this validate that Jesus really was the promised Savior, but it also validates the prophecies, because if they were not from God, God would not have honored them. But God did. Number seven is this, the evidence of accuracy. Have any of you ever played that game, telephone, where you whispered in somebody's ear next to you, and then they whispered into the person's ear next to them, and then they whispered in? It's a great game if you want to laugh, because what is originally said to what comes out at the end is usually nothing close to what it is. And so how do you know that what we're reading today, what was written down years ago, how do we know that? Well, down through the years, many have doubted the historical and geographical accuracy of the Bible. Yet modern archaeologists have reportedly unearthed evidence of the people, places, and cultures described in the Bible. And time after time, the descriptions in the Bible have been shown to be more reliable than anyone ever believed. Those who have traveled to Israel marvel at the geographical and historical backgrounds in the Bible. Number eight is this, the evidence of changed lives. The Bible is written to change lives, and that is what it does. Until I started reading the Bible for myself, I believed there was a God. I believed there was a God. I believed there was a Jesus. But that was it. But since I did not read the Bible, I did not know how to live for Jesus. I didn't even know what to do for Jesus. And when I started reading the Bible, God showed me what I needed to do, and he changed me. Missionaries take the Bible into remote villages where people have never even heard the name Jesus, have not heard anything about the Bible, read to them about Jesus, and people give their lives to Jesus, and they're changed. Because of reading the Word. Over the years, the Bible has changed many people, and the Bible continues to change people today. In a little bit, in fact, we're going to baptize five people, and their lives have been changed by the reading of the Bible and accepting Jesus into their lives and asking God to forgive them of their sins. The Bible changes lives. The ninth one is this. The Bible fits together. The Bible is sort of like a puzzle. Everything fits together and it makes a beautiful picture of God in heaven. And I'm not sure how many of you watch television series, but I find it interesting of the inconsistency of some of these long-time series. Because in season one, the actor may say his hometown is in Indiana someplace. In season eight, he says his hometown is in Texas, and they don't match up. It's the same person. And it doesn't match it. And that's only been 8 years. And we forget what we have said if it's not the truth. But when you tell the truth, everything stays consistent. Nothing changes. 40 different people wrote some of the Bible, but it was all inspired by God. And it was all the truth. So what was said or written about it in one part stays consistent in another. With the Bible being written over all those years by so many different people, there should be a bunch of contradictions and inconsistencies. But there are not. And the last one is this. You don't die for a lie. There was a follower of Jesus named Peter. In fact, he was a disciple of Jesus. When Jesus was alive, Peter told Jesus that he would always be by his side, that he would never leave him, that he would always be right beside him, that he would protect him, that he would die for him. And then Jesus was arrested and Peter ran away. When Jesus was being tried that evening, Peter went to the trial and he, in fact, was standing in the crowd and he told people that night three different times, I don't know this Jesus guy. When Jesus died on the cross, Peter was just devastated. And then Jesus came to him and told him that he loved him and forgave him. Peter then went on to speak to a large group of people on a day called Pentecost, and 3,000 people came to accept Jesus that day. Later on, Peter was told to stop talking about Jesus or they would kill him, but Peter said he would never stop talking about Jesus because Jesus was the truth and people needed to hear the truth, and Peter never did stop talking about Jesus. And one day they did kill Peter for speaking out about Jesus. In fact, 10 of the 11 disciples were killed for speaking about Jesus, for telling the truth. If the story that these disciples were telling was not the truth, they would have run away and stayed away. But they didn't. Instead, they came back. Instead, they came and told the truth, and they died for the truth. Everything that we read in the pages of the Bible is truth. Now, you may have a number of people in your life to tell you differently, and some may even make fun of you for reading the Bible. But I don't want you to get discouraged. I don't want you to give up. I don't want you to stop, because what you're reading is the truth, and I hope and believe that you believe the same. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for this morning, for Pat's message, for this message, Lord, of the truth of Scripture, that there is truth. And while the world tells us that truth is whatever we say it is, that's not the case. Truth comes from you, and we can read that truth within your word. And I pray, Lord, that as we are gathered here this morning, that the truth of your word would penetrate each and every heart that is here this morning, Lord. Lord, I want to pray for those who are going to be baptized this morning. I want to thank you for them. I want to ask, Lord, that you continue to help them live their life as you desire them to. We realize, Lord, that we have this morning some who are young, some who are older. But Lord, I pray that you will continue to speak the truth into each one of their lives and guide and direct them. Because, Lord, the truth of your word is the only thing that we can really hang on to that's always going to stay the same. It's not going to change. And so, Lord, as your truth has entered into these people this morning, has changed them, has caused them to believe in you and want to follow you and do everything that they can for you, I pray, Lord, that you would make that even stronger in the days to come for each and every one of them. Lord, I want to thank you for them stepping out and saying, I believe And Lord, I just pray that you would bless them. I pray this morning, Lord, as they are baptized, it will be a wonderful, special event for them that they will never, ever forget. Because today, Lord, is the day that you are going to meet with them. They are going to stand before you, and they are going to proclaim that they are yours. And we thank you for that. And we ask all of these things in your name, when all of God's people said, amen. Amen.